Hi, this is Dr. Claire, and this is our lecture on gametes and fertilization. So the gametes are the sperm and the egg. So when you're going through sexual reproduction, you have to produce these cells that will combine with cells from another individual in order to form a new offspring. So we're going to talk about how these gametes form and how they come together to be fertilized and a little bit about development. Your book focuses a lot on human reproduction. I'm going to touch on it, but I'm actually more interested in comparative reproduction and some of the other animals, so we're not going to focus on it too extensively. All right. So let's start with production of sperm. So this is actually a production of sperm in the human, but it's similar for most vertebrates. So if you look within the testes where sperm is produced, there are many, many, many coiled tubules. These are called the seminiferous tubules. That means sperm-bearing tubules. All right. So those are where sperm is produced. And so if you look at a cross-section of one of these tubules, there's a layer of cells. And at the outer layer of those cells are what we call the germ cells. These are the cells that are ultimately going to divide and become sperm cells. So those germ cells in the outer layer divide, and one of the cells starts to migrate towards the inside of the tubule. As it migrates, it divides again. It goes through meiosis. Remember, meiosis is the type of cell division where you get half as many chromosomes as you used to have. So they go through meiosis. The end product of the meiosis process is four new spermatids, which are the cells that will actually become the sperm. They then have to mature for a little while, and eventually they are released into the center of the seminiferous tubule. They actually then will move from the seminiferous tubule into a structure called the epididymis, where they're stored until ejaculation. So males are constantly making sperm. Sperm are very inexpensive. They're really cheap to make. It's generally beneficial to have a big supply of them. And so males are continuously making sperm in pretty much every species. And so that these stored sperm stay in the epididymis and just await their opportunity for ejaculation to occur and for them to go forth and try to find an egg to fertilize. All right, so let's take a look at the sperm. Most sperm have a very similar structure. They are made up of three different components. You have the head region. That's where the nucleus is, so that's where the genetic information is contained. At the tip of the head region is the acrosome. That acrosome generally contains compounds that assist the sperm in penetrating the outer layer of the egg. Eggs have defensive mechanisms that prevent sperm that are not of the same species from penetrating the outer layer. So the acrosome has species-specific compounds that help them to get through that outer layer of the egg. Then you have the body of the sperm. That's kind of the powerhouse of the sperm. It's full of mitochondria. It's going to be breaking down sugars and making the sperm able to move, and it's able to move using its flagella, which is the tail. It basically just whips around and allows the sperm to swim through a liquid medium. So sperm are mobile. They can go pretty long distances, and they actually often have chemoreception that allows them to detect signals that are put out by eggs and swim in the appropriate direction to get to the egg. This is particularly important if you have external fertilization, like many aquatic organisms have. Female gamete production is a little bit different. At least in vertebrates, generally all of the eggs that you're going to have for your entire life are developed during fetal development. So by the time you're born, you have all the cells that are going to become eggs, and you don't make any more of those. Unlike unlike in males, eggs are not produced throughout the whole life of the animal. So you have these germ cells, and they start to develop into what's called an oocyte. That oocyte then will stay in suspended animation until it's time to ovulate. So it'll just wait until it's time. And then right before ovulation is actually when meiosis starts, at least in humans. So meiosis starts right before ovulation, so you get those two cell divisions that occur. And rather than making four eggs, like the sperm cells did, when they went through meiosis, they ended up with four sperm cells, you get one egg and three what are called polar bodies. That's because the egg has to be larger. It needs to contain more resources for the developing embryo. And so the polar bodies are basically just getting rid of the excess genetic material. And then the egg itself is got all the mitochondria and everything that it needs. In humans, at least, the second stage of meiosis happens immediately prior to fertilization, so it's pretty late. So if you're looking at a female reproductive system, our ovaries are where our oocytes are. They're stored within there. They will develop slowly, one at a time. Those are called these follicles. So if you look at a bird ovary, for example, you will see several developing follicles, and a bird egg, when it is laid, has a yolk. And so there's a yolk that's associated with those eggs that grows gradually over time. So if you look in a bird egg, you'll see the eggs it's going to lay for the next few days, because a bird lays one egg per day. And so you'll see a big yolk and a slightly smaller yolk and a slightly smaller yolk, because it takes several days to actually make the yolk. In mammals, it's a little bit different. So we have these developing follicles that are getting ready. At ovulation, the egg is released. This is when mitosis is actually happening. The egg is released into the fallopian tube. Fertilization usually occurs in the fallopian tube if it's going to, and then if the egg is fertilized, it will go and implant within the uterus, hopefully. Meanwhile, the follicle where the egg was developing becomes a structure called the corpus luteum, or which is actually very important for hormonal regulation. So actually, let's talk a little bit about hormonal regulation. So this is hormonal regulation of the menstrual cycle in humans. So basically, what happens is that you have, the first thing that happens is that you have an increase in estradiol. This is produced by the ovary, and that leads to a surge in a couple of hormones, luteinizing hormone and follicle stimulating hormone, that actually will trigger ovulation to occur. So those two, there's a big peak in those two hormones that triggers ovulation, that releases the egg into the fallopian tube, and then you have your corpus luteum, which remains. That corpus luteum then produces its own hormone. It produces progesterone, and the combination of progesterone and estradiol that is continuing to be produced by the ovary will maintain a thick uterine lining. And so if the egg is fertilized, it will travel down the fallopian tube for a few days and then hopefully implant within that uterine lining. If it does, it'll start to produce, the embryo will start to produce its own hormones that will then regulate maternal hormones and maintain high levels of estradiol and progesterone, which will keep the uterine lining thick and healthy. If the egg does not implant, if it's not fertilized, or it just doesn't implant for some other reason, then eventually the corpus luteum will degrade, it will stop producing progesterone, the estradiol levels will also lower from the ovary, and then you'll actually go through menstruation. So when those two the progesterone and the estradiol decrease, that's when you slough off that uterine lining and you start the cycle over again. All right, so you've got sperm, you've got eggs, you got to have fertilization, right? So when a sperm and an egg combine, the sperm actually will penetrate the wall of the egg. It will deliver its nucleus to the egg, and then the two nuclei will fuse, and then you go from a haploid sperm and a haploid egg to a diploid cell. That's the zygote. And then the zygote divides and starts to form the embryo, okay? When the sperm arrives, the first thing it has to do is that the egg has to recognize that this is an acceptable sperm. If you have external fertilization, that's pretty important. There's a lot of sperm floating around out there, and you don't want any old sperm to fertilize you if you're a egg, because it will reduce your fitness if you have a sperm from a different species to fertilize you. So it has to recognize, there's a recognition that they're the same species. The plasma membranes then fuse. Once they fuse, then any additional entry of other sperm has to be blocked. And if you think about it, that's really important, because if, let's say, you have a sperm and an egg and they come together, but then another sperm comes in, now how many copies of the chromosome do you have? You've got three, right? So now you're triploid. What do we know about triploids? Do you guys remember from back in the day? Triploids are generally sterile, so it's really bad to be fertilized by more than one sperm. So you got to block any additional sperm from fertilizing the egg, and then you have the fusion of the nuclei within the cell. All right. So let's take a closer look at some particular fertilization events. This is an example from external fertilization. This is a sea urchin fertilization. Sea urchins have been very extensively studied for embryonic development, because it's really easy to get gametes from sea urchins. You can inject them with a particular hormone and they will release sperm or release eggs depending on whether they're a male or a female sea urchin. And then you can just combine them in some salt water and watch things happen. So a lot of work has been done on sea urchin eggs because it's so easy to work with them. So the sea urchin egg, there's many different species of sea urchin. So sea urchins have to make sure that only sperm from their own species are able to get into the egg. And so they have what's called a jelly coat, which is this this thick coat of like proteinaceous material. And within the acrosome of the sperm is a compound that will digest that jelly coat. And so only sperm of the right species have the right compound to get through the jelly coat to the egg. So they have to get through the jelly coat, and then they get to the vitellin envelope, which they also have to penetrate through to get to the cell membrane, which then they fuse to. All right. And so that's how fertilization works in a sea urchin. In a mammal, it's a little bit different, but a little bit the same. Mammalian eggs are surrounded by a bunch of small cells in a gelatinous matrix. It kind of acts like the jelly coat, except it's called the cumulus. And again, the sperm has to penetrate through that jelly coat to get to the egg. Underneath that, rather than the vitellin membrane, they have the zona pellucida. So it's another barrier for the sperm to get through. Okay, so very similar. It's generally difficult for the sperm to actually get to the membrane, and that slows them down so that they're not all arriving at once, so that the egg can then block additional sperm from fertilizing. So this is, again, going back to the sea urchin. This is what happens to avoid polyspermy in sea urchins, to avoid more than one sperm fertilizing the egg. First you have what's called a fast block. So when the sperm membrane fuses to the cell membrane of the egg, there's a switch in the membrane charge. So ions flood across, kind of like the signal in nerve cells. You have a change in the membrane potential so that the egg becomes positively charged. This is going to help to repel any additional sperm. Then you have what's called the slow block. In the slow block, water is actually pumped into, well, it's not water, ions are pumped into the membrane, the space between the vitellin membrane and the cell membrane, and then water follows because of osmosis. So you get a physical barrier of a gap of water between the vitellin envelope and the cell membrane so that any future sperm that come can't get to the cell membrane. They're blocked. And that prevents multiple sperm from fertilizing a single egg. All right, that's our lecture on fertilization and gametes, and I'll catch you next time.